Good evening. Good evening. My name is Dele Ogunseitan. I am a professor and chair in the program in public health here at UC Irvine. And I'm thrilled to see this wonderful turnout. Some of you I've known for decades, others I'm just meeting tonight. And I know that this is going to be the beginning of a long interaction and productive that we all learn about what's happening in our environment. I also want to acknowledge all of those who worked very hard to put this event together. I'm not going to name too many names, but most are associated with the organizations that are listed on this introductory slide. This is one of several events that we have collaborated to put together and welcoming our community to learn with us. The Newkirk Center, just a recent change in leadership. Professor Simon Cole was named the director of the Newkirk Center just a couple of weeks ago after a long and productive, successful leadership of Professor Joseph Demento. So we're very thrilled about the promise and opportunities that the Newkirk Center has brought to our campus. The School of Social Ecology has also been a formidable partner in this endeavor. The School of Law and the program in public health of which I am a part and represent here tonight. Together we have worked to produce stimulating programs under the Sustainable 21st Century project. There are many ways that you can die slowly by a rubber duck. This is a picture of Sydney Harbour. This was taken January 5th, just a few weeks ago, in Australia. The artist who did this is Dutch. His name is Florin Hoffman. And this is shocking to people because we just are not used to seeing the poor little rubber ducks at this scale. But we're going to talk tonight about a different kind of rubber duck. And the scale is nonetheless impressive and shocking. And I'm sure we will all have gained a lot of knowledge about this challenge after the presentation by our guest of honor, Bruce Lurie. Bruce is one of Canada's leading environmental thinkers and co-author of this book here. It's an international bestseller, not surprisingly. Slow Death by Rubber Duck, The Secret Danger of Everyday Things. He is president of Ivy Foundation, a private charitable foundation in Canada. And in his downtime, he directs the Ontario Power Authority and a director of the San Francisco-based consultative group on biological diversity. He is an honorary director of the Canadian Association of Physicians for the Environment and a member of the World Wildlife Fund's Climate Advisory Committee. Bruce is a founder of a number of for-profit and non-profit organizations, including Summerhill Group, a prominent consulting company in Toronto. The Sustainable Network, a highly regarded capacity-building organization, and the Canadian Environmental Grantmakers Network. He has acted on numerous international, federal, provincial, and municipal bodies advising on environmental and energy policies issues. He has a degree in geology as well as in environmental studies, and I understand he's close to earning a doctorate degree, but I'll let him talk to us more about how he came to write this wonderful book and how we can support the course. Before we bring Bruce to the audience, the person who will actually give this introductory talk is a colleague here at UC Irvine. And it's not every day that you get to open your newspaper article and you see a story. This is a, I was reading the newspaper last week, and Nicholas Kristof had written an essay on warnings from a flabby mouse. And in the story, the picture that you see here was part of the story, and two genetically identical mice, one exposed to endocrine disrupting chemicals, very small amount at birth, and the outcome was essentially permanent. As I was reading this story, this was just January 19th, I saw, of course, that my colleague was cited as the source of all this trouble and commotion about endocrine disruptors. He coined the word obesogens in an article that he wrote a few years ago now, and I put in bold some of the things that academic scholars are familiar with. You come up with a creative idea, it's controversial at first, and then we slowly build the evidence to support it. And the work on obesogens is now widely accepted, it's basis for policy, and we can't be prouder to have Dr. Bruce Bloomberg as one of our faculty at UC Irvine. So without further ado, I will introduce Bruce, and he will talk to us a little bit about his work, and then we'll bring Bruce Lurie to the podium. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Deli. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be here tonight and to introduce our wonderful speaker and to talk about a topic that's near and dear to my heart, and that's the topic of endocrine disruption and how it is that small amounts of chemicals that we encounter all the time might have long-lasting and deleterious effects on our health. So maybe I should start by talking about what are endocrine disruptors. So how many people in this audience have ever heard the term endocrine disruptors? That's pretty decent, about 30%. That's better than many audiences. So the most recent definition of an endocrine disruptor came actually from the Endocrine Society. An endocrine disruptor is a chemical or mixture of chemicals that interferes with any aspect of hormone action. And as you may or may not know, many very essential aspects of our life are regulated by very low doses of hormones. So we're perhaps most familiar with the sex steroids. So the women in the audience are very familiar with estrogen and the estrogen receptor, and men with testosterone and the androgen receptor. The thyroid hormone receptor controls our body's basal metabolic rate, how many calories your body needs to run itself. And there are actually 48 different hormone receptors that respond to a variety of hormones in the body. And any of these can be disrupted by chemicals in the environment. I became interested in this topic because I'm a hormone receptor guy, and it turns out that many of these work through the family of genes that we work on, the nuclear hormone receptors. And the Environmental Protection Agency has designated estrogens, anti-androgens, and anti-thyroid as the endpoints, as we say, of interest. Endocrine disruptors can act much more widely than that. So we have a variety of receptors and pathways in the body, and I won't go through all this and bore you. But the kind of take-home message here is that many, if not most, of the important functions of our bodies are controlled by hormones. Endocrine disruptors can affect many hormone systems in the body. As I said, the thyroid hormone receptor, if you disrupt it, you can get attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, hyperthyroidism, learning disabilities. Anyone heard of those? The estrogen and the female reproductive system, breast cancer, ovarian cancer, precocious puberty is a problem these days, polycystic ovary syndrome. We've perhaps heard of sperm counts dropping around the world, interfering with the function of the testosterone receptor can have an impact there. We established a different target for endocrine disruptors, and that's that they can affect metabolism and obesity. And this was a heretical idea 7 years ago now, but the evidence mounts and it's probably less heretical now than it was then. This is a chart from colleague Tracy Woodruff at UC San Francisco, and what they're showing here is the list of disorders that have increased over the past years. You can see testicular cancer, autism, ADHD, a variety of birth defects that have to do with the sex organs. Reproductive function is declining over time. This is all happening in the last 30 years or so. And every single one of these adverse outcomes can be associated with exposure to endocrine disrupting chemicals. I have to say that in this country, the concept of endocrine disruptors was not widely accepted until just a few years ago, until the Endocrine Society, which is not a radical organization, but rather a very stodgy old scientific society, published the first position paper in their 86-year history, laying out the evidence for the existence and the effects of endocrine disrupting chemicals. And just to summarize, they showed that there's mounting evidence for effects on a variety of endocrine pathways and effects. In 2009, the American Medical Association adopted a resolution where they said that we ought to study more about endocrine disruptors, and we as physicians ought to help our patients to understand and to minimize their exposure. And there was a bill a few Congresses ago called the Endocrine Disruptor Prevention Act of 2009, which would have had the very important effect of moving the responsibility for research from the EPA, which is sadly unduly influenced by the industries that they regulate, to the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences, which is not. That failed, but we hope that that may make it through a future Congress. And this is important because if you talk to people in industry, they will say, you know, there are endocrine disruptors, but it's really not a problem, and no one's exposed, and no one knows how to study endocrine disruptors. And this cartoon kind of summarizes it. This guy who's grown a very large set of breasts is taking a cautious wait-and-see approach to needless media scaremongering. And it's funny, but it's actually sad but true. So here's a list of what we currently know as endocrine disrupting chemicals. It's not a complete list, but you can see that in every different kind of category of chemicals that you may encounter, herbicides, fungicides, insecticides, a whole host of industrial chemicals. Who's heard anything about the controversy about bisphenol A in recent years? There are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of studies by academic scientists showing that bisphenol A is dangerous, yet it's not enough for the Environmental Protection Agency or the Food and Drug Administration to ban. Luckily, our friends north of the border in Canada have realized that bisphenol A is likely to be a toxic substance, and they've so labeled it. And I've heard that the California EPA is about ready to make bisphenol A a Prop 65 chemical. So that's a very welcome outcome. You can see these chemicals in many places in your everyday life. I said pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, solvents, flame retardants. Californians are the most highly exposed population in the world to flame retardants because we have very strict guidelines about flammability of furniture, for example. Industrial byproducts, surface protectors, plasticizers. Plastics are a big trouble. There's a host of endocrine disrupting chemicals and we're exposed. And you'll hear from Bruce Laurie later about some of the worst of these. This is important because as a developmental biologist, I set out to study how does the embryo become patterned from early in life. And what we know from work in a variety of labs is that exposures to a variety of things early in life, and these can be chemicals, it can be drugs, it can be improper or inadequate nutrition, have permanent effects on the organism so exposed, whether they're animals or whether they're people. And the conclusion that's developing is that many, if not most, or even if not all, chronic complex diseases have origins in early life exposures. So just a plug for the work that we do. I'm not going to go into any great detail because this is not a night for me to tell you about our work. But I and my colleagues have been studying whether disturbances in endocrine disruptor-mediated signaling pathways are responsible for our kids looking like this. And we live in California. We don't see too much of that. But the reality is kids are getting fatter and fatter all the time. Childhood obesity has more than tripled in the last 20 years. And you can get big, strong-looking kids that look like this, but Sadly, sometimes they get to be adults that look like this. And this is rising and rising and rising, and we need to understand why it is. And the conventional model of calories in, calories out, all calories are the same, eat less calories, is not working. We need another approach, another explanation. So I'd like to talk just briefly, as an introduction to Bruce's talk, about the myths and realities in endocrine disruptor science. And the first myth that many of us have is that the EPA, under the aegis of the Pesticide and Fungicide Act or the Toxic Substances Control Act, is testing the chemicals that we're exposed to and making sure that they're safe. How many people think that's true? At least a few of you. The reality is the EPA doesn't test anything. And the EPA trusts the manufacturers of the chemicals to do the testing and then inform them of the results. Another myth is that they practice what's called the precautionary principle. That is, that if a chemical might be dangerous, that we're better off without it. And in fact, that's not true. And in the law in the United States, we have two standards. One standard is preponderance of the evidence, where more or less 51% of the evidence is enough to say that someone is liable or not liable. And then we have beyond a reasonable doubt in the criminal law. Well, actually in chemical law, it seems to be beyond the remotest shadow of a doubt before we can get a chemical off the market. And in fact, since TSCA has been enacted, only a handful of chemicals have been banned. Another is that they are checking whether we're exposed to chemicals and making sure that the public is not exposed to hazardous levels of any chemical. Sadly, there is no exposure testing being done except for NHANES, which is done by the Centers for Disease Control. Almost all exposure assessments are based on computer modeling, and only very rarely is anything tested. And that's one thing that's even worse in Europe. The European Food Safety Authority relies exclusively on computer modeling to know what people are exposed to and what they're not. And the other is that EPA and other agencies use state-of-the-art modern science. And sadly, I was just at a meeting last week at the EPA, and they don't use modern science. They're using almost Stone Age science, at least 30 or 40 years old. And in modern biology, things are changing so rapidly that even 10 years old is Stone Age science. So what are the issues that I think we need to talk about, and maybe you'll think more about after Bruce's talk? The first is that it's required that there is some testing for chemicals, industrial chemicals, fungicides, pesticides, but never these data see the light of day. So the testing is done, the companies show it to the EPA and put it back in their secret vaults, and it's never seen again. So I think that shining some sunlight on that might be a good thing. And we've seen in the past, for example, with the cigarette industry, that when you look at the data, you sometimes are surprised at what was there. How can we evaluate the quality of the data that's being used for regulatory decisions? How is it that after hundreds and hundreds of papers, the Food and Drug Administration can't decide whether or not to ban bisphenol A? It's actually shocking. How can we incorporate the data regarding all these endpoints into the regulatory decisions that we make? How can we get modern science into public policy? How can data on very low dose effects? So this is an extremely controversial field. Risk assessment in the EPA is dominated by the field of toxicology. So where scientists are trained to take very high doses of chemicals and that kill most organisms and then titrate the dose down and down and down until you don't see much effect. And then you eventually reach a level that's called the no observed adverse effect level. And that's the level that's used to set how much we're allowed to be exposed to. But what if you look lower than that and there are effects? So in the endocrine disruptor community, we find effects at very low doses, in many cases much lower doses than are allowed to be safe. And these results are not really being discussed as much as they ought to. And the last and biggest problem is, how can we continue to rely on the manufacturers to test their own products for safety? Does that make sense to anyone? That's a fundamental and very deep conflict of interest, and we need to agitate for something to be done about that. So what's the take-home message? This is a silly slide I got. said Daisy Bubbles and Elrod suspect that someone is slipping super hormones into their feed. And it's funny, but it's actually not so funny. So here's a fish from Florida, and you can't see it that well. But this is what's called an ovotestis. This animal is intersex. It has characteristics of both sexes. And animals don't develop that way normally. Endocrine disruptors exist and affect our health, and not just our health, but the health of wildlife and our companion animals. These effects often occur at doses that are far below those are what tested in traditional toxicology. As I said, once toxicologists get down to an area where there's no effect, they stop testing. Those of us in endocrinology come from the other level. We come from no dose up until where we see an effect. And often there's a big gap between those two. And that's mystifying to toxicologists, but to endocrinologists, it's absolutely understandable. And that old style toxicology is what's used for risk assessment to determine how much of which chemicals we're allowed to be exposed to. And the last, which is perhaps a good lead into Bruce's talk, if food products were honestly labeled, chemical helper, artery clogger, acrylamide chips, ADHD flakes, the environment that we live in is not optimal for our health. And it's up to us to do something about it because the government is not going to. So we need to act locally and advocate for ourselves in order to change this. So I'll stop there. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce Bruce Laurie.
Oh, that was a fantastic introduction, and I, in fact, it's never happened before where I have a scientist explaining, probably in greater accuracy than I will end up, a large part of what this book is about. So, Bruce, thank you so much. And I should point out, too, that it is a good segue because really what my co-author Rick and I did was try to take a whole bunch of science that is out there that, frankly, we found shocking. We work mostly in the policy world, so we try to get the regulations in place. We talk to chemical companies. And if it weren't for scientists like Bruce, if it weren't for people like Pete Myers, a good friend of ours who he referenced, if it weren't for people like Fred Vomsahl doing the BPA science, or Theo Colborne, we couldn't do the work that we're doing. So for us, what we did was basically try to translate that science in a way that hopefully is meaningful and readable for you. So to that end, Rick and I wrote this book, and it's in fact came out just over 3 years ago now. And our goal really was to try to show pollution in a new way. So if I asked you, what was the first thing that would come to mind if I said to you, like, what do you think of when you think of pollution? What comes to mind?
Smog.
Of course, we're in California. Smog, yes.
Cars.
Yeah. Smog. You also think, people think of, you know, smokestacks, you know, big pipes going into lakes and rivers. So what people don't realize is that, in fact, the modern sense of pollution is in our homes. It's in our carpeting. It's in our furniture. It's in our plastics. It's also in our food, and sadly, it's also in the toys that our kids use. So we came up with the idea. I mean, several people this evening asked me, you know, where do we come up with the title and why a rubber duck? Well, really, it's because we think of these big smokestacks when we think of pollution, but we don't think of things like rubber ducks, which, you know, really nothing could be more thought of as more harmless or more kid-friendly than a little toy rubber duck. And ultimately, when we consume all of these different things, when we live in our homes, eat the food, the kids playing with these toys, the pollution ends up in us. So pollution isn't out there, pollution is inside us. And that was the message really we're trying to get across. So the rubber duck, you know, kids are vulnerable, products that look innocent, and ultimately, there's unintended consequences. So the other thing people don't realize is that there are an estimated 84,000 chemicals in commerce today. So again, when Bruce mentioned that we're not doing chemical testing, when governments actually aren't testing the safety, it's not on a few chemicals, it's on 84,000 chemicals. These isn't for you to read, but just to give you an idea that They're everywhere. And a vast majority of these chemicals have been created post-World War II, many of them, in fact, during World War II. So we did, for the book, we were doing work with an environmental group where we actually started looking at the levels of chemicals in people's bodies. And a number of tests were done showing that people actually have all of these chemicals in their bodies. And in fact, if you take blood samples or urine samples, other samples, you'll find that the average person will have anywhere from maybe 80 to 200 chemicals in their bodies, synthetic chemicals in their bodies. So when we set out to write the book, we wanted to measure these chemicals in our bodies and really answer this one question, like, how do these chemicals get in us? And we came up with this clever idea. Well, clever, I blame Rick for this idea, which was we knew we would have to test our own bodies and figure out how many chemicals we had in our bodies, but we thought, rather than just simply testing our bodies, why don't we see if we can't raise the levels of these chemicals in our bodies by deliberately consuming different products, exposing ourselves to these things, using shampoos, using lotions, heating our food in microwave plastic containers, eating tuna, things like that, and just see if we couldn't, we're curious, like, could you actually watch these chemicals going in your body? And that sort of led to one more question, which was, you know, certainly the question our families were asking us was, were we crazy? But we had one cardinal rule when we were doing these tests, and that all of the tests had to mimic reality. So my little quote there is a reference. It's sort of that, you know, the anti-science reference when people say, oh, well, sure, you did that study on rats, but if that was a human, they'd have to eat 400 tons of that for 100 years before you saw anything. So we didn't do crazy things. We did things that every American would be doing every day in terms of the experiments that we did. So there's thousands and thousands of chemicals. Of course, we couldn't write a book about thousands of chemicals, so we chose seven. And I call them the seven deadly synthetics. So the first one, phthalates, it's a plasticizer. Well, phthalates, actually, it's an interesting chemical. It's got a couple of characteristics. It's a plasticizer, so the rubber duck on the front of the book. Most rubber ducks are not rubber. They're made of vinyl, PVC, polyvinyl chloride. So if it weren't for the phthalates, they would be like little hard, crispy rubber ducks. They wouldn't be nice soft rubber ducks. So vinyl shower curtains, anything that's, but many soft pliable plastics will have phthalates added to them. It also has this interesting property of carrying scent. So you'll see on almost every single personal care product, whether it's a shampoo, a lotion, a deodorant, a perfume, even things that are kind of deodorizers, they have phthalates added to them. PFCs are perfluorinated compounds. Those are everything from nonstick frying pans to stain repellents, things like Stainmaster, StainGuard. And I was quite disturbed to find that one of my very favorite products, Gore-Tex, is in fact a perfluorinated compound. So anything that kind of resists stains and liquids. PBDEs, they're polybrominated flame retardants. Again, Bruce referred to flame retardants and the fact that people here in California, all of you, probably have more flame retardants in you than most of the rest of the world. They're quite nasty products. And then mercury, which is the only one of those that isn't a synthetic chemical, it's a natural element, but one that we know is very serious, a neurotoxin. We looked at triclosan. Triclosan's an antibacterial chemical. It's in literally in everything from sandals to running shoes to underwear to sports clothes, hand lotions, soaps. It's just like everywhere. Anytime you see the word antibacterial, there's a very good chance that it's going to have triclosan in it. Pesticides, don't have to really explain those. And then bisphenol A, and we'll talk a little bit more about bisphenol A. So, of course, once you go out into an audience and start talking about all these chemicals, a lot of people just really have no idea what it is that you're talking about. I should point out that if you've ever wondered about any of your favorite characters in the world, whether or not there's a rubber duck version, there is. So as part of our experimenting, we basically, over a 48-hour period, locked ourselves up in a condo and did a whole bunch of tests. And as I said, there was nothing unusual about this, you know, except that we locked ourselves into a condo and did all these tests, except that we actually had somebody come in and take on a periodic interval, you know, blood and urine samples, and then we had them sent to labs and analyzed. So after 48 hours of using products that we knew would contain phthalates, and the only way we knew, we didn't really know, but we suspected contained phthalates, because we chose very fragrant products. So as I said, it carries scent. So if you're buying, rainforest shampoo and strawberry lotions and things like that, they're gonna likely have more phthalates in them than things that aren't as heavily scented. So we did the tests, 48 hours, MEP is a metabolite of phthalates, a 22 times increase in phthalate levels in our body after doing that test. PFCs, this was probably the most disgusting test. We actually hired somebody out of the Yellow Pages to come in the condo, spray stain-resistant spray on the carpet, the sofa, the curtains, and then we closed the door and blocked the vents off and sat in there for 24 hours. And the worst part is, and then we didn't see any results. So we're not 100% sure. We had scientists in universities advising us on all of the experiments, and the fellow Bruce Mayberry at University of Toronto suspected that either the chemical was not the right chemical formulation, they're very specific, or else because there's already so much elevated levels of perfluorinated compounds in us, that it would have taken a much longer amount of time for them to accumulate. But anyway, we did find them in us, but we just didn't see a big spike after the experiment. There was one amusing thing, though. I'll see where this one. When I went into the kitchen to make a tuna sandwich, and I stepped onto the kitchen floor, which was tile, and I just went zzz, slid right across the kitchen floor, because of course it's a nonstick chemical, the PFCs. So they really work if you want to have fun with that. Tuna, so 7 meals over 48 hours, which maybe is a little bit unusual. A couple of tuna sandwiches, I had a tuna sushi and a tuna steak, and I eat fish primarily for protein, so I already knew I had slightly elevated levels. But my mercury levels went up actually more than 2.5 times over that 48-hour period into a level that's considered to be unsafe. And a lot of people eat, I know people that eat tuna, 3-4 times a week, right? People think tuna's healthy. I mean, fish is good for you. So people eating a lot of tuna are gonna have very high levels of mercury. Triclosan, this was the one that was really crazy. And the fun thing with triclosan is you actually know it's in a product. So we have some listed there. How many people here use Colgate Total toothpaste? Come on. Yeah, it's about a third. Colgate Total toothpaste is the single largest selling toothpaste in the United States. Also happens to be the only toothpaste with triclosan in it. And so the reason that you actually have to label triclosan on the toothpaste is because triclosan is a registered pesticide. So you'll be happy to know you've got a registered pesticide in your toothpaste, which I like to say is for that bug-free smile. So we saw a 2,900 times increase in triclosan levels over a 48-hour period of using products that we knew had triclosan in them. Pesticides, thankfully we didn't do an experiment. That was one of my chapters. We typically did our experiments on our own chapters, and Ontario actually had just announced a cosmetic pesticide ban, so I used that as an excuse. I'd be breaking the law if I sprayed pesticides and rolled around in them. This is a real ad, which I think is just so much fun. You know, all these little farm animals and the farm wife singing, DDT is good for me. In case it's not clear, DDT is not good for you. But I always figure if you call your company Killing Salt, you know, it probably gives you a bit of a hint. Anyway, DDT was one of these products that came onto the market, but unlike most of these other chemicals, because of our regulatory system can't deal with it, it was very clear very quickly that DDT was a real problem, and it was regulated amazingly quickly for a chemical. Bisphenol A, or BPA, that's a chemical that's used predominantly in hard, clear plastic polycarbonate bottles, baby bottles, for example. And it also lines the can, lines tin cans, so almost every tin can lining has BPA in it. And Bruce referred to in Canada, we got BPA baby bottles banned, and that was, in fact, largely the work of my co-author and the organization that we're involved with, Environmental Defense Canada, that over about an 18-month period, we worked very closely in. And in fact, the I don't know if I have a slide here. No, we brought up scientists, and we did we had a little demonstration with babies holding placards, and it was a very, very effective campaign. And at the end of it, the Minister of Health and the Minister of Environment, federally in Canada, decided to ban BPA, and they actually said using the precautionary principle. And it was, like, to me, unbelievable that we would have sort of a conservative federal health minister stand up and say, we're going to adopt the precautionary principle and is better off making babies safe than not knowing what the implications are. So a great example of the application of precautionary principle in chemical regulation. And Canada was the first country in the world to ban a BPA product. So here's that duck again. I think this one's in France, though. Anyway, I don't know, that's not the Australian one. So so people always ask, you know, is this really a big problem? And in the early days, the chemical companies, when you talk to them about these issues, they said that, well, sure, we have these chemicals in these products, but they're inert. They don't get into your bodies. And then so obviously with the book and the testing we did and other research out there, we've shown that that's not the case. These chemicals do leave the products and they do get into your bodies. So now what they're basically saying is, well, sure, maybe little tiny amounts of these chemicals get into your bodies, but they don't really cause any harm. But the reality is, not only are they getting into our bodies, but these chemicals are everywhere. So 95% of Americans have BPA in their blood. There's recent studies on testing the blood in umbilical cords showing that babies are born with these chemicals in their bodies. You look at something like BPA, polar bears in the Canadian Arctic have BPA in their bodies. So these chemicals just spread out around the world and end up in all of our wildlife and in humans. Well, we've heard a lot from Bruce, and just a great, that was a fantastic presentation, by the way, Bruce. Really, like, I loved it. So the links to, you know, what I call these, like, modern epidemics, right? I mean, how many people know kids now that have asthma? How many people are going to school with kids that have peanut allergies? You know, ADHD, you know, obesity that Bruce researches. Cancer is sort of the obvious one. Diabetes, thyroid problems. Like, these health issues have increased so dramatically over the last couple of decades. And for some of them, interestingly, they're increasing more in industrialized nations. So you have to wonder, you know, really, what is going on? I'll just give my sort of more simplistic definition of endocrine disruption. And basically, it's looking at the endocrine system, which produces our hormones. And it just takes, I think what people don't realize, and certainly what the chemical companies don't tell you, is that it takes tiny, tiny amounts of hormones, natural hormones in your body, to make dramatic change as your body develops. So why would it not take the same tiny, tiny amount of a synthetic hormone to result in some kind of dramatic change in your body? And the one that really was of concern that we were working on with the baby bottles was BPA, in that it mimics estrogen. And so we know that elevated levels of estrogen contribute to breast cancer, and it just doesn't make sense that we're going to be producing these plastics that are elevating levels of estrogen in people's bodies. So, and of course, again, you know, Bruce Robert referred to various, you know, reproductive problems that we're seeing as well in epidemic levels. This is just a figure to describe fairly graphically what we're seeing here. So we have on this side normal breast tissue, and you can see how the mammary glands develop in normal breast tissue. On this side, it's breast tissue that has been developed with 25 nanograms of BPA in, and this is mouse breast tissue, and you can see that this is a tiny, tiny amount of bisphenol A, and it has a dramatic effect on the way that the breast tissue develops. For us, it's really a new way of looking at how we understand toxicology and how we understand these chemicals. So it's not so much the quantity of the chemical, but the timing at which these chemicals might be introduced. And certainly it's the developing fetus and babies that are most affected. Rick and I were both in the meeting with Theo Colborn last year, and it was just a room full of endocrine scientists. And we're not endocrine scientists, we're just people that, we have science degrees, but we just translate the science. And so Rick and I were sitting around the table, and everyone's talking about non-monotonic curves and, you know, other stuff. And so at the break, I said to Rick, do you know what non-monotonic is? He's like, no. And anyway, it's I call it a U-curve, but it could be. I know it does other things, but that's my symbol. Non-linear, which means it isn't straight. the other one is this idea that in toxicology, it used to be the dose makes the poison, i.e. the more of the toxic chemical, the more of the toxic effect. And that's been shown to be not the case with endocrine disrupting chemicals. And then also that you're starting to see effects of these chemicals either, again, as Bruce pointed out, either later in life or even multi-generational effects, which isn't what you typically see or test for, or have regulatory systems to be able to deal with, which is really the big problem with these chemicals. So when I speak a lot in various settings, and you know, parents groups and nurses and things, and so I always like to point out who should be concerned. But really, at the end of the day, you know, if you eat food or drink water, you probably want to be somewhat concerned. This is a little slide of one of the girls that was in our demonstration, holding the little placard on the front of our Ontario legislature as part of the BPA campaign. And I should point out that one thing that really motivates Rick and I, and we tell many stories in the book about organizations who have basically, you know, whether it's at a community level or, you know, a provincial level, or whether it's doctors groups or nurses groups or scientists who present and speak out on these issues, you know, we're actually seeing some great progress. And I know just even today, talk to people, you know, at the Ecology Center here and the Coast, was it Coast, Coast Keepers, you know, these great organizations that I'm so happy when I come to these things and hear people telling me the great stories about the successes that they're having locally. So we tell many of those stories in the book, because those are the things that ultimately are making the changes that we need. I found this about like a week after Obama was elected. Someone had an Obama rubber duck. I have to say we were a little disappointed. Things didn't go as well as we were hoping in the first term. But here's just a few things, and I'm going to look at them because I just put this together. Since the book was written, you know, just last year, Denmark bans phthalates, DHP upgraded to a possible carcinogen in Canada and the U.S. Canada actually has classified BPA as a toxic chemical, which is a big deal for us, for our legislation. Europe is I don't know if it is or has... announced a baby bottle ban last week. I think, Bruce, that's what you're referring to. California announcing the intent to declare BPA a reproductive hazard. Rick and I were just in New York a couple weeks ago doing some work and with NBC, and we said, oh, we'll just go out and buy some BPA microwavable containers. Well, it's easy. We'll just find them at a local grocery store. We're going through all the containers. We could not find one single BPA plastic container for sale. And these companies, this is like companies like Rubbermaid. All the Rubbermaid containers used to be BPA. And they're not even telling anybody, but they're all pulling them off. So just that kind of regulatory threat and the health studies that are out there is having an amazing effect on what corporations are doing. Just anyway, a bunch of other things. Canada just about a month ago announced declared triclosan as a toxic chemical to the environment. So we're actually encouraged that things are happening and we're moving forward, which is exciting because for a lot of years nothing was happening. And then I find this interesting too in Canada. Six of the Canadian provinces, including three of the largest ones, have banned entirely the use of cosmetic pesticides. So you are not allowed to apply cosmetic pesticides anywhere in the majority of Canada right now. So that's big stuff when it comes to direct exposure for people to these chemicals. So lots of rubber ducks all working together. And I just want to finish off with a few tips and a few things to think about. The book actually has, and thanks to whoever it was that is providing you all with a book, that's very generous. But the book has quite a few very specific tips in it, but I'm just going to summarize a few of them here. I think it's really important for people to pay attention to what they're buying and ask questions. And if you aren't asking questions in the stores that you're buying stuff from, then they're not going to know that you're concerned. So it's really important, I think, that you always do that. In terms of the bottom line for us in this research, I think we discovered pretty clearly and pretty graphically that these chemicals are, of course, in all of us, and they're in these products, and they get from the products into our bodies. The good news side of these chemicals getting into our bodies is that once we stop using the chemicals, so if you don't use Colgate Total, if you don't use Dial soap, if you don't microwave your food in plastic, you know for sure you will have lower levels of these chemicals in your bodies. You won't have zero because it's, the chemicals are everywhere, but you can dramatically lower your levels immediately by avoiding these products. And Rick and I are actually just writing a second book right now, and that's really going to be the focus of the second book. Excuse me. And then finally, what we've seen, and this is a lot of the work that we do, is at that intersection between consumer purchasing actions and corporate behavior, and then ultimately government regulation. And I think all of those things coming together is how how we make ultimately make progress. And then finally, just some really specific things. So you shouldn't ever heat food in plastic, and it's a lot of people still. Oh, how many people here still have the odd lunch in the microwave in a plastic container? Yep, yeah, quite a few. So just you can buy these even at places like Costco. You can buy these glass storage containers that you can put in the fridge and take them out and put in the microwave. Use those. And then a pretty easy thing to avoid things like phthalates and lots of other personal care products. In fact, we're as well on this stuff, Rick and I are doing a lot of research on cosmetics now, and it is unbelievable how many cosmetic lines in the last 5 years have started to shift to much cleaner products. So look for things that say no fragrance, or you'll see very specifically they might say phthalate-free or paraben-free, or there's like a zillions of chemicals. But you can buy really good really good products out there, personal care products. And a very specific one, tuna really is, and not just tuna, but primarily tuna, shark, swordfish, tilefish. You shouldn't eat any of those if you are pregnant. They're very high levels of mercury, and mercury is a really serious neurotoxin. Don't buy any nonstick stuff. Don't buy any stain-free stuff. These are just some simple things that are out there that you can start avoiding. And finally, I don't know what the pesticide laws are in California, but really, of all the chapters, I would say of all the things I looked at, pesticides scared me more than anything in terms of the evidence of cancer related to pesticide exposure. Pesticides freaked me out. So don't buy or use pesticides. So with that, I'm going to thank you. And if you want more info, I've got a few websites listed here. And if all goes well, we'll have book two out in January. And if you keep an eye out on NBC Dateline, sometime in March, I think Rick and I are going to be on NBC Dateline talking about the book. So I will end it there, and I'm going to take some questions. But thank you very much.
Can you comment a little bit on children's sleepwear, which was which contained a high level of flame-resistant materials, and whether there has been any effort to remove these from children's sleepwear?
Yes. Yeah. So yeah. In fact, children's sleepwear did have the polybrominated flame retardants in them, but no longer does. So I think, and I don't know if California has some strange specific regulations that still requires it, but my understanding is that the polybrominated flame retardants are no longer in any children's products. In fact, there's different categories of that chemical and or different variations of it, and the majority of them have been banned already, and there's a couple left that are going to be phased out over the next several years. So the flame retardant story is actually a reasonably positive one.
Good evening. I have been hearing something on the effect of microwaves and the change on polarity of the magnetron. Have you heard of it?
Or change of polarity?
The polarity of the food.
Actually, we're just doing a little bit of work on electromagnetic radiation in the second book. And it's, I have to say, it's a very complicated field. And I think there are certainly people who seem sensitive to it. But I think it's a small proportion of the population that have some kind of sensitivity to EMF.
Having covered pollution and workers in factories and living near industrial areas, I would just as color commentary ask that you not necessarily cross out those smokestacks because those folks are exposed even more than us.
Yes.
But anyway, leaving that aside, so we have now it's up to 84,000. I thought it was just 80,000 untested chemicals. So if we stop using the Colgate total or the Old Spice, how do we know really safely what to use? Is that going to be addressed in your book? Is there any hope on knowing what truly may be safe since the overwhelming bulk of it is just an unknown?
Yeah, it's always difficult. I mean, even, whether it's maybe some of the flame retardants being replaced with things. I know some of the BPA alternatives aren't so much better. People ask me about Teflon pans.
Yeah.
There's now like green Teflon, which is really just a variation of not green Teflon. So, but I think what you want to do is try to avoid the actual category, like avoid antibacterial products, avoid nonstick products, like use a stainless steel frying pan, use a cast iron frying pan. A lot of the natural toothpastes are very good. I mean, toothpaste really, there's a big debate about fluoride, which I kind of sit on the fence on, to be honest. If you don't want fluoride in your toothpaste, you can buy non-fluoride toothpastes. Most toothpastes don't have triclosan, so it's pretty easy to avoid a lot of those things, but if you want a stain-resistant, sofa, you're probably going to get some other chemical that's not that great for you. So maybe just don't buy a stain-resistant.
I look forward to the book with the tips.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Hi. Thanks for the talk tonight. I just had a question about sort of your perspective on the potential for regulatory efforts when we have an increase in the transnational nature of commodity chains and how that leads to further ambiguities in the market when the consumer's trying to make decisions about where product even came from, much less the regulations on the chemicals in that country, and what standards we can have for imports, much less exports?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. It's certainly difficult. There are many, many examples of products that are coming into North America that have been found to be contaminated. You know, there was it cadmium in jewelry or something that was coming in here? You know, there's leaded toys coming in paints. And, you know, so countries typically will regulate a product to be sold in the country. So it should apply to everything coming in. But the difficulty is really enforcing those laws and how much spot checking there is. And it's all about, you know, enforcement. And I'm reasonably confident that a global company that, you know, if you start getting regulation, say, in Europe and Japan and Canada or something, and it's a company that's selling a global product, then they sort of see the writing on the wall, and they'll probably phase it out and look at an alternative. But if it's not, then it's much more difficult.
Yeah. One more comment really quick is, with the example of DDT that you gave, we've seen innovations toward more systemic pesticides being used here in the United States, the results of which are unknown, like many of the chemicals you've described. So it's a curious question what companies actually do in response. Is it innovation? That leads to new untested chemicals, and
where does that leave us? That's a great question as well, and I'm hoping, I haven't quite gotten there yet, I'm hoping to answer that in the new book, which has a chapter on green chemistry. And so what the chemistry industry is doing right now is trying to set up protocols to predict whether or not chemicals will be toxic. And it's quite interesting what they're doing, and this isn't fringe, this is Dow and DuPont and BASF. And so they're developing very sophisticated models to try to predict chemical formulations and look at, you know, what are the characteristics that might make it, you know, an endocrine disruptor or, mutagenic or toxic or, you know, various things. And there's also, and then even more out there are companies that are trying to look at how to manufacture the same kinds of chemicals. Like almost all our chemicals are petroleum-based chemicals, but how do we make chemicals that are water-based chemicals? I mean, that's really the kind of the holy grail, I think, of green chemistry. So it's, and I'm still not sure whether that's a lot of talk or whether it's going to be real, but there are genuinely, you know, big companies that I think are struggling with this right now and doing some sophisticated work on it.
Would you agree that it's impossible to live in a chemical-free world? Because, like, some things that are, like the chemicals that are deadly to us, the other things in it, like, that could potentially hurt us in other ways. Yeah.
Well, it's impossible to live in a chemical-free world, that's for sure. So, okay. I mean, the chemicals are everywhere. So I think the first step for us is just try to avoid exposure to things that we know we can avoid. And that'll at least reduce our overall exposure. That doesn't mean we're not going to be exposed to lots of other things. There's, you know, look around in a house or an office, the carpets, the furniture, the, you know, your vinyl cabinets, the glues. I mean, there's chemicals everywhere.
So is there anything that could, like, replace chemicals in a way? Like,
not really.
Yeah.
The goal would be to try to replace toxic chemicals.
Okay.
And, or reduce the exposure. But, I just didn't, like, in my house, I buy wooden cabinets that have toxic-free glues. And, like, you have to look a little bit. And, but there's certainly far better products out there than what the typical product is.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
Did you guys gain any weight when you were doing these experiments? And did you lose any weight when you started avoiding these toxins?
I don't know if it was
without any changes in your dietary habits, of course.
Yeah, I think the French fries might have been more of a problem. I didn't mention that, just speaking of French fries, the PFC chemicals also line pizza boxes, French fry containers, microwavable popcorn bags. And so you have, and PFC actually has been determined to be an obesogen. And the studies that they're doing in Parkersburg, West Virginia, where they manufacture the PFC sort of chemicals, You know, they've done this huge study, and one of the results is showing that that PFC, in fact, is an obesogen. So you've got a chemical that lines French fry bags to keep the grease in that also makes you obese. It's really kind of a triple whammy.
Yeah, I work in the hospital, so triclosan and other industrial chemicals are used to completely sanitize the area. And there's definitely some studies that show, doctors that, use their hands with the hand sanitizer promotes like decreased infections in the hospital. But have you found any alternatives to that? Have you talked to the hospitals about those kinds of things?
Yeah, and this is where it's, this is tough. So the triclosan that's used in hospitals is very concentrated.
I know, it's worse.
And so it's worse on one hand because it actually it's worse because it's concentrated. But the one of the real issues with triclosan in things like, Dial soap or hand sanitizers or toothpaste is that there isn't enough triclosan in it to actually kill all of the bacteria. So what it does is it contributes to, superbugs or, resistant bacteria. And so that's the reason why both the Canadian and American Medical Associations have called for a ban on the domestic use of triclosan, but not medical use of triclosan. So, because it's used at strength, But to answer your question, I don't know of alternatives. I mean, they would have had them years ago, but I don't know what alternatives are in hospitals.
Okay, thank you.
I was surprised you didn't mention parabens, which are in all kinds of personal care products, implicated and found in breast tissue.
Yeah, it was just a simple matter that we had to choose a small number of chemicals that we could research and write about, but parabens are certainly one that you want to be concerned about. And again, the good news is there are a lot of labeled paraben-free products. So we have terrible labeling regulations. So what we're seeing now is, as opposed to requirements for companies to label things that are bad, you're starting to see voluntary labeling of things that are good, which is kind of the market alternative. So you'll see paraben-free or scent-free or, some of the personal care products, they'll list five different things that they don't include.
Okay.
Hi. I really appreciated that you called out the consumer power that our purchasing choices have. Could you speak more to what we can do as individuals to affect change at the kind of company or policy level?
Yeah, I think there's a few things. In fact, I was, I don't know how many people know who Annie Leonard is and the story of Stuff, and I was just talking to Annie about exactly that the other day. The difference between, are we consumers or are we citizens? And she's kind of moving toward we're citizens, we're not consumers. I mean, the reality is we're both, and you want to exercise your power both ways. So if people, like for example, when we were doing the BPA bottle campaign in Canada, we started going to all of the companies that we thought might be more progressive, like the equivalent of REI in Canada and those sorts of companies, and they voluntarily started taking all the BPA bottles off the shelf because we said we're going to come out with all of this media and it's going to look really bad and you guys are going to look bad. And so that's one way to do it. And then the more people that you have, like in organizations that have membership, like Environmental Working Group is one of my favorite organizations in Washington, and they actually mobilize, thousands and thousands of people to either write letters or send emails to companies or say we're going to stop buying your product. And that stuff, that really works. So getting involved in organizations that are doing that is really huge. Or as I said, just if you're at a store, say like, why are you selling this? Or is this BPA free? Or is this, whatever you're looking for? And and the more people that do that, the more they'll realize that they have to offer that to customers. So it's kind of a multi-pronged approach, but the more involved you are and the more you ask, the more power you have at the end of the day.
Bruce has given us a lot of food for thought, not including flavoring, but he also told us to act locally, and sometimes we have to act regionally. California has now, for 4 years, the so-called Green Chemistry Law, or the Safer Consumer Products Law, in Sacramento with back and forth public hearings. This is a chance for you to contribute to the debate. The law will essentially ban products that contain many of the chemicals that we heard about tonight from consumer products sold in the state of California. It's a landmark law, but again, we're struggling with those with who have special interests to keep some of these chemicals in commerce. So please take a look at the website of the Department of Toxic Substances Control. It's been a lot of work for many of us in the science and the industry activist community. And public hearings are still continuing. You can send your comments by email. The last time my graduate student looked at the list of commentaries, it's running to about 1,000 pages long. And so we're looking forward to the passage of that law, but it will take a lot of work of people like Bruce and all of you who've heard some of these stories to contribute to that effort. So this is a wonderful catalyst opportunity for us to have Bruce personally be the guinea pig for some of these procedures. But join me to thank the two Bruces, particularly our guest of honor, who will hit the road, I think, not too long from now. But feel free to come back to California. The first experience you had, we wouldn't repeat it. But this is a good chance to get to know us even more. And we look forward to continuing the collaboration.